What's the most exciting thing happening in Australian wine today?
Australia's rediscovered its belief in itself. Australia, people old and young in Australia, are realizing that what made them famous in the world of wine 30 or 40 years ago, what made them loved in the world of wine 30 or 40 years ago, and what made them emulated by the whole of the rest of the world of wine was this fantastic self-belief. And there's also a great belief in flavor and character in wines, not copying other people, saying, we're Australian, we do it this way, we think this is the best possible flavor at a fair price to make the most consumers happy. And I think that they've found that again. And I think it's young and old. There are people in their 20s and people in their 60s who are going back to the core of Australia, which basically means is about over-delivering wines with flavors which are genuinely Australian and genuinely recognizable as such.
So they've got their mojo back, basically.
They've got their mojo back. Yeah. And you want to say, come on, fellas, where did you put that mojo? Why did you put it in your back pocket, take your jeans off, put a suit on, put a tie on, start talking marketing gobbledygook, and all of us over in Europe saying, I don't know, who are these strange people from the southern seas? I remember you as being people full of life and enthusiasm and arrogance and self-belief and brashness, and now you're all wearing a suit and giving me marketing nonsense. They've taken the suits back off, they've put the jeans back on, they've put their Williams boots back on, they've stopped shaving, they've stopped washing, and they've started believing in themselves again. Well, Australia's going to have to cope with global warming. It's hitting Australia just like it's hitting Northern Europe, just like it's hitting Southern Europe. At the moment, it's a culture built strongly on things like Shiraz and on things like Chardonnay. The cooler areas are obviously very keen on Pinot Noir, cool climate Shiraz, maybe sparkling wine. There are areas like the Yarra Valley who are finding patches getting too hot for Pinot Noir. There are areas like parts of the McLaren Vale which are getting too hot for Shiraz. I think that Australia, and this is where someone like McLaren Vale and someone like, you know, our friend Steve Pamel is very important, that Australia is going to have to start becoming a laboratory for change. And they are beginning to look at Italian varieties, red and white, because after all, if it's getting too hot for Chardonnay, sure as hell it'll be getting too hot for Sauvignon. And then what about Riesling? I mean, Riesling is surviving at the moment, but you wonder how it survives in the Clare Valley and the Eden Valley. I think they will start looking, and indeed some people are, at things like Fiano and Falanghina, these kind of grapes, maybe Greco, all those. There's a marvellous range of Italian wines from places like Campania. I think they should, and one or two people are, start looking at things like Acirtico. I mean, there's a couple of Acirticos, I think, being made now. Greece is full of good red and white grapes, particularly white. I think what one finds in the Mediterranean is a surprising number of superb white grapes, which over 2,000 years have just got, or 3,000 or 4,000, they're used to the sun, they're used to the heat. They've mutated and developed into being slow-ripening, small-yielding, slow-ripening, holding on to acidity under the hot sun. There's lots of stuff from Spain, and Italy and Greece particularly, which they could use. To be honest, they should look at some of the stuff that's grown in places like Dalmatia, in Croatia. And when it comes to reds, well, they are using things like Nebbiolo. There's a couple of excellent, Steve Pannell's Nebbiolo being a classic example. Nebbiolo, though, is a strange old grape. I mean, I wouldn't think it's going to be the saviour of anybody, but it's going to be the joy of a few people. I don't think Sangiovese is quite good enough a grape. There are much better grapes around. Tempranillo has become extremely popular. I would like to see more effort put into some of the Portuguese styles. I noticed that they're using things like Touriga Nacional now. Let's have more of those kind of wines. Tinta Cao, Tinta Franca, Touriga Franca, Touriga Nacional. Those kind of grapes. There's a tremendous future for them. And people are just nibbling away at them. Things like Ayoritico from from Greece. Let's, come on, fellas, let's have a go at it. He's that Nero d'Avola from Sicily. Come on, lads, let's see what you can do. Some of those grapes, you just think, gosh, when they're made in a very European way, they're good. What would they be like in the hands of those marvellously hedonistic winemakers that Australia's got so many of? They could be absolutely thrilling.